The Bears lapsed into non-competitive mode Sunday in a 313 loss to the Eagles, their most lopsided defeat of the season, as the NFL's best team illuminated the chasm between Super Bowl contenders and basement dwellers. The fan base's patience with coach John Fox drained closer to empty, with the Bears at 38 and spiraling on a four-game losing streak. Many fans want accountability, some action to acknowledge the team's unwillingness to settle for the status quo. More specifically, they want Fox out post-haste, but true to the franchise's history of eschewing in-season coaching changes, Fox remains in place as the Bears turned their attention toward Sunday's home game against the woeful 49ers. Without playoff hopes, what would the Bears accomplish by jettisoning their coach? On the other hand, what's the point in keeping him in place through December if change is inevitable? Bears reporters Rich Campbell and Dan Lederer examined the questions surrounding the embattled coach in this week's Real Talk. Rich Campbell: Dan, let's start with an acknowledgement to the readers. We understand your frustration and anger. The cumulative effects of humiliating losses such as Sunday's are painful. It's unfair to be so emotionally invested in a team and repeatedly get nothing in return. Regardless of how many consecutive losing seasons fans endure, it's impossible to fully get accustomed to the disappointment. That said, I understand why ownership and general manager Ryan Pace would stick with Fox to lead the Bears against the 49ers, a game in which they're favored by 3.5. Losing on the road to the NFL's best team was never going to be the last straw. Save those thoughts for potential December home losses to the 49ers or Browns, or apply it to the November 12th loss to the Aaron Rodgers-less Packers. Keeping Fox at least maintains order entering a winnable game, and the high level of defensive effort late the second half Sunday suggests he hasn't lost the team. Considering the remaining schedule, the Bears are on pace for 511 or 610, which is what most realists expected they would be. Dan Lederer: We've spent weeks now providing specific details of Fox's failures. There's his 12-31 record overall and 313 mark in NFC North games. There's the sobering fact his Bears have suffered through 7 losing streaks of at least 3 games but have never won 3 in a row. There's the reality that the Bears have never been at .500 at any point during his tenure. Well, how about this indictment of a coach who loves to trumpet that the Bears often play close games? After Sunday's pummeling in Philly, they have suffered 9 losses by at least 17 points since 2015. By contrast, the Bears have only 2 wins by that much. And by the way, they're 818 in games decided by 8 points or less. Amid those facts, it's hard to preach patience to an increasingly aggravated fan base, but it sure seems as if Fox's dismissal is fait accompli. A paced coaching search should be done by mid-January. A new course will soon be set. So the next question is simple with a big picture in mind. Other than satisfying an angry urge, what truly would be accomplished by firing Fox before season's end? Campbell: A loud majority of the fan base is out for blood, and sacking Fox would at least appease them. For any business, there's something to be said for satisfying the customers, but it would be easier to hit the detonator if Fox had lost the team or the team had frayed. It's important to distinguish between a team that has quit and a team that's just not very good. And in my estimation, the Bears kept playing hard Sunday despite the insurmountable deficit. Let's push forward. I fully expect Pace to target a new coaching staff that resembles the quarterback incubator the Eagles have around Carson Wentz. Perhaps that rules out defensive coordinator Vic Fangio as the next coach. However, Pace could audition Fangio for the role and get a genuine look at his game management style, replay challenges, clock management, etc. That would make sense if it has been determined change is inevitable. Coaches who have worked with Fangio praise his game management. He had a heavy footprint with the 49ers earlier this decade. He covets a head coaching opportunity, and he would accept an interim role as a showcase if he were presented with it. Lederer: Let me be the first to throw the eye roll emoji at the "they're still playing hard" argument. We are well past offering credit for that, in my opinion. But I get what you're saying. And part of what you're implying is also that the environment at Hollis Hall hasn't become extremely toxic. To this point, there have been few indications that major dysfunction has crept in. And, having lived through 2014, we can recognize the differences in how the building feels. The Bears don't have a diva receiver challenging opposing fans to boxing matches. They don't have an offensive coordinator anonymously ripping the starting quarterback and later confessing. There's no overwhelming tension hovering every day, not yet anyway. As for Fangio, I talked with him at the end of 2015 about his desire to be a head coach, and this quote stuck with me. "It's something I believe I would do well at," he said. "And I think I would be deserving. Those are the reasons it would mean something to me. I think Fangio could be a very good head coach. He's a great teacher, an impressive strategist, and an obvious leader. He deserves an opportunity somewhere, but long-term, based on the Bears' priorities of grooming Mitch Trubisky, I'm not sure this is the ideal fit. As you mentioned, the Bears should be aiming to assemble a quarterback-centric coaching staff to take their franchise quarterback to the next level and beyond." Campbell, after getting to know Fangio's personality and coaching style over the last three seasons, "I'd be very intrigued to see him in a head coaching role. He's a proven strategist in the Mike Zimmer mold. The Vikings coach has done well developing that team after getting a head coaching opportunity late in his career. Like Fangio, Zimmer isn't known for his presence, but just look to the top of the NFC North to see his results. Hypothetically speaking, if Fangio were to become the Bears' interim, I wouldn't expect the team to suddenly stop committing penalties or have key contributors such as Leonard Floyd and Cameron Meredith suddenly get healthy. But maybe they wouldn't send the punt team onto the field on 3rd and 17, pull them back and still have to call a timeout because only 10 men were out there, which was part of Sunday's sloppiness. As we ponder an in-season coaching change, we have to ask ourselves the same question that will shape the off-season plans: what's best for Mitch? Weeder, that question will be the compass of just about every decision the Bears make in the months ahead. But for these next 5 weeks, I'm not sure I have a definitive answer. I do know major changes are coming soon. And while an in-season coaching change isn't an outlandish suggestion, I'd need to hear more convincing arguments on the perceived benefits. Obviously, firing a coach in season is not unprecedented. And as some of the trigger-happy crowd will point out, two of the teams the Bears should be using as models, the Rams and the Eagles, fired their last coach during the year. The Rams jettisoned Jeff Fisher in Week 15 last season, handing the steering wheel to Jim Fassel for the final three games. The Eagles pulled the plug on Chip Kelly in Week 17 of 2015, giving Pat Shurmur 1 week of interim duty. Still, the idea that those early firings pushed those teams closer to their next coach is debatable at best. The Rams hired Sean McVay on January 12th, the fourth NFL team to fill a head coaching vacancy last winter. The Eagles found their way to Doug Peterson on January 18th, 2016, trailing six other teams in the head coach replacement race. Campbell, even if the Bears send Fox on his way in December, the effect on Trubisky would be marginal. They've opened up the passing game a bit since the open date, and, to be fair, they haven't won since removing Fox's oversight wouldn't change that. Offensive coordinator Dal Logan's and quarterbacks coach Dave Ragone guide Trubisky's day-to-day work. Regardless of what fans think about that, it's good for Trubisky to hear the same voices and go through the same processes daily as the Bears attack winnable games ahead. The continuity is valuable as he tries to squeeze some winning, confidence-building moments out of the next five games. One other point: this entire conversation should be fluid. As the Bears play out the string, Pace must continue to evaluate the team's cohesion and buy-in. The results also are important. In other words, do not lose to the 49ers, Weeder, or the Browns. There's no telling what will happen in the 5 weeks ahead, but if we are using the past three seasons as our guide, we can expect some encouraging moments from the Bears. And we undoubtedly can expect a few more losses. On Monday, Fox said he talked to his 38 team about two numbers, 313 or 88. The message was that the Bears still have a say in where this season ends up. In the preseason, you pegged the Bears as a 511 team. I had them at 610. Still seems about right, and we know that change at the top is almost certainly coming soon. So my message to those who need a firing right now is deep breath, be patient, you'll have what you want soon enough. Daughter Campbell at ChicagoTribune.com, Twitter at Rich Campbell, Twitter at ChicagoTribune.com, Twitter at Dan Wiedererra, and Fish Stinks Up Hollis Hall, as if Bears don't have enough problems with failures mounting and hope fleeting, Mitch Trubisky must learn to endure most inept performance of John Fox era calls for immediate change at Hollis Hall.